Welcome back to the Broadman Word, and last week, it was not the best week for me. Definitely not. I did get COVID, and it was not fun at all, but with that, I am back. My voice is pretty much like 90-95%, still a little bit of breaks here and there, but I'm happy to be back with the Broadman Word, and we're going to continue on through the book of 1 John. And today we're going to look at what does it mean to idolize something. But on top of that, we're going to talk about the Antichrist and who that is. Now, we're not going to identify the Antichrist. We're not going to do that. But we're just going to talk about who that is and why this person is important for believers and why it's important to even be talking about this. So with that, turn with me back to 1 John chapter 2. We're going to go to verse 15. So 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. So, let's stop there. So when it says, do not love the world or the things in the world, when John says that, he doesn't mean to go out and be like, oh, this beautiful tree is awful and it should be cut down immediately. And he's not saying, go up to your neighbor and be like, hey, the Bible says do not love the world or the things in the world, and you are in the world, so therefore, I don't love you. Like, don't go around doing that. That's not a good idea. But what is he getting at? Is he talking about that everything that we see and that we touch and that we taste and that we smell, that they're all just awful things and we should never experience joy from them? Not at all. But he's getting down to the point of where do we put our desires and things, and where do we put things on the throne of our heart, basically. So when I say this, here's how it kind of breaks down a little bit. The end of verse 15, if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now, again, for instance, like, I love my family. Does that love of family mean that I don't love God? Of course not. But sometimes what can happen is that your family or your possessions or whatever it might be takes the place of God on the throne of your heart. And when we're talking about the throne of your heart, we're trying to paint a picture of your heart being like a throne, and the person sitting or the thing sitting on the throne is the thing that is governing or ruling your heart. And that should only be God. It should be. But because we live in a sinful, fallen world, idolatry is the thing. And idolatry is not just this Old Testament idea of a statue that people would bow down to or sacrifice to. It's not just that. It is this idea of treating something that is not God as God. It's pretty much just that. And he kind of breaks this down a little bit more too. Verse 16, for all that is in the world is not from the Father, but is from the world. Okay, well, what are those things, John? It's in the middle of that. For all that is in the world, it might have a comma or a dash, but then it says the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life. Now, I could still desire having a family. So what are we talking about here? The desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life. These are all with sinful motivations behind them. The desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes. So the things that we crave within ourselves are the desires of the flesh. The desires of the eyes are the things that we lust after, that we covet, that we see, right? And then the pride of life is this idea, or pride of possessions. You could talk about this. So the pride of life's blessings or life's desires, but you could also say pride of possessions. So things that we crave internally, things that we lust after or that we covet, that we see, and then things that we take pride in, that we have. The things that those are the things that we should stray away from. And the world is, but here's the thing, and this is why it's so important to understand idolatry. Those things, those idols, are passing away along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever. And again, whenever we say whoever does the will of God, it doesn't mean that you do so perfectly, but that you're striving to do so. I think that's kind of what it gets at. And then we get to, so you have this talk on idolatry, and then you have this switch to talking about the Antichrist. And I think that's not a coincidence that we go from idolatry to the Antichrist, because the Antichrist is trying to take the place of God, basically. So with that, let's dive into this section. Verse 18 of 1 John chapter 2. Children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, so now many Antichrists have come. Therefore, we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us. But have you been anointed by the Holy One, and you all? But you have been anointed by the Holy One, and you all have knowledge. Now, before we get into more of that talk, there, what is he talking about here? So, the last hour, he's not actually talking about the last hour, like the actual an actual hour, because if that was so, then you and I wouldn't exist. We wouldn't be here, right? And so what is he talking about when it comes to hour? He's talking about a period of time. So we're in this last period of time, or this last stage of time, that we typically call in theological academic circles, we call the church age. This is the last hour. This is the last stage of earth. Now, it may last thousands of years, right? Like it has, but it's, we're in the last stage. And because of that, there are going to be figures that come that are going to do their best to deceive people. And they are known as Antichrist. Now, there is one Antichrist that is coming, but there are figures that are deemed Antichrist that have come, that give us a picture of the utter just destruction of man. But there is one Antichrist that is coming that will be way worse than all of those. And it's interesting here in verse 19 that he's talking about, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us. Here in verse 19, I think he's talking about people that are just going through the motions that seem like they're believers, but they're not. They're really not. And then they go on to attack the church instead. And I think that's kind of what he's getting at in verse 19. So I think that he's writing this to a group of believers that have seen this happen. And he's saying, look, this is not just a one-time thing. This will continue to happen to the church in the church age. But at the same time, don't be discouraged by that, because you have been anointed by God, and you all have knowledge. And it's interesting that he puts that there, that word knowledge, or that you might know everything, or that you have all that you need to know. And it's interesting here, and he continues on here in verse 21, I write to you not because you don't know the truth, but because you know it, and because no lie is of the truth. And what is he talking about here? What lie is that? Verse 22, who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, he who denies the Father and the Son. So he's talking about the coming of the Antichrist, and that the believers will know who he is when this person comes. Now, we can debate all day about pre-trib, about mid-trib and post-trib, but that's not for this video. That's for another day. But it will be obvious to believers who the Antichrist actually is when this person comes about. Because the Antichrist will seem perfect. He will seem wise and smart and has everything together and is and accepts everybody kind of thing. But deep down, he's just waiting to unleash the evil that is the Antichrist. So with that, verse 23, nobody who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. Makes sense. Verse 24, let what you heard from the beginning abide in you. If what you heard from the beginning abides in you, then you also will abide in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he made to us, eternal life. Verse 24, what is the thing that you have heard? The gospel, which results in eternal life, according to verse 25 and to the New Testament as well. Verse 26, I write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you, but the anointing that you received from him abides in you, and you have no need that anybody should teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about everything, and is true, and is no lie, just as it has taught you, abide in him. So, as we are facing a culture that is very much against Christ, and not only that, but there's these folks that are out to to lie, to deceive about the gospel and about the Bible and Christianity. And not only that, but there's this one figure coming, the Antichrist, that will be the ultimate liar and deceiver. It is important that we abide in Christ. And what it means to abide is to really just yes, it means to live in, but it really is much more than that. It means to abiding in somebody means to cling to them, to really latch on to them, to basically to depend on them. And while we face this culture that is becoming more and more negative to us as believers, that is even more true. And because we abide in him, we are given the truth that we need to face the lies and deception of the culture that we live in. And because of that, he continues on with this idea of abiding and being children, for us being believers and followers of Jesus, being children of God. He continues on with that concept, and we'll get to that next time on Thursday. But with that, I'm so happy to be back here with the Broadman Word with you all. And we will continue on with the book of 1 John. And as we continue to strive to see how do we combat the persecution that is coming for believers, or is already there in the lives of some believers. So with that, we'll continue on Thursday. However, I'll see you with Broadman Word tomorrow. Thanks.